Welcome back to another episode of Sound Pals Go to the Movies. This is another Throwback Thursday review, and I'm here with my friend Tuli. Say hi, Tuli.
Hi, guys.
And today we're going to be reviewing RoboCop from 1987. And just fair warning, there's going to be spoilers up ahead, so you've been warned. In a dystopic and a crime-ridden Detroit, a terminally wounded cop returns to the force as a powerful cyborg haunted by submerged memories. So first on my list of pros is the movie didn't need to be rebooted. This movie is still great. It still holds up, but still has some minor aging details that I'm going to go over. But overall, it still works even to this present time, which brings me to my following points. First, the special effects, the stop motion effects on the ED-209 for the 80s. That was impressive, and it still is in some retrospects. Second point is that the RoboCop suit, combined with the acting skill of Peter Weller, who portrays Murphy, the RoboCop, is to me the perfect combination, because he himself is who makes RoboCop and brings the suit to life. We couldn't have the suit by itself or have the actor by himself. We needed both together to make this work. In a sense, Peter Weller made the suit come alive and really sold the idea of man and machine. That combined with my third point, which is the sound editing. This added to the mix, and you get yourself what I think is the closest thing as to Robotech, Transformers, or Cyborg live action movie back in the 80s that we could have gotten. Next point is, back in the day when I saw this movie when I was a kid, back when it was on VHS, I remember watching a few things that got past me. And one of the things was, for example, the idea that how Officer Lewis found out that RoboCop was actually Murphy from the spinning of the gun that he told her that he was practicing because his son liked the TV show TJ Laser. To me, that just went above my head when I was a kid. And now when I saw the movie, it just was like, wow, I didn't catch that detail. When I was a kid, I just liked the action. The next point is that I really didn't see the spoof commercials that played a lot of impact into the details of this society. Talking about the board game, I think was called Nukem, and the heart surgery hospital commercial. That was all tongue-in-cheek jokes, which I kind of didn't understand when I was a kid. But now when I see it, it brings it into a different kind of light, and it makes me laugh at these kind of jokes. There was one other thing that I kind of got really impressed after watching it. The idea that one of the bad guys, Clarence, when he was about to kill one guy and he played back a video of the guy who was actually sent to kill him, he put a disc, and this is before DVDs were made, and this is I think about 10 years before they were made, which to me seems like, wow, they were ahead of their game and they sort of predicted stuff like this. But in reality, the whole movie had to think ahead, because of course they were predicting the future. These are some things that I missed when I was a kid, but I really like the fact that they're in the movie, as almost as I like the fact when they touched upon the reference for the laws of robotics from Asimov in their own version, which they called the three prime directives that RoboCop had to follow. To me, this adds another detail that they actually knew about some things that had to do with robotics. And now on to my cons. First, there is no backstory at all to the Murphy family, so I didn't feel anything when they sort of left him after he died. As far as I was concerned, they were never really there in my case, so I couldn't care less if they were there or not. So when Murphy was looking for them, I didn't feel anything. So here's an idea that I kind of thought about. Why not have Clarence hit one of his henchmen, somehow put Murphy's wife in the hospital, then when she wakes up, she identifies one of them, which makes Murphy go out in search of revenge, which leads him to get killed. And then when his wife finds out, she feels guilty that he died in search of revenge for her, so she ends up leaving the city with her son. Then Murphy gets turned into RoboCop, and that's where the story picks up from. We also need a little bit more backstory to Officer Lewis, because she seems like she was an afterthought. She was just put there because Murphy needed a partner. She really didn't have a backstory. All she did was just follow him around, give him assistance. Also her acting. Some scenes between her and Murphy seemed below average in the acting department when it's between her and when Murphy is a RoboCop. But that's Murphy's a RoboCop, so he's kind of has to act like a robot, but she's human. So to me, the thing is that she has to take it up a notch. So I needed to see a little more energy from her, and I needed to have her character have a little more backstory so I could get interested in her and Murphy as partners. My last con is going to be that awkward thumbs up that Johnson gives RoboCop at the end after RoboCop shoots Dick Jones. And that to me was the most awkward thumbs up ever in that smile. So that's a con on my book. So I guess that does it for me. I'm going to pass it on to my friend Tuli and see how he saw the movie and what grade he gave the movie.
Like Sal, the first time I saw this film was as a kid when it came out on VHS. Back then when I saw it, I pretty much watched and enjoyed the film for the action aspects of the film. I saw the movie through my kid's action sort of mentality where it's like, ooh, look at this guy who got transformed into this robotic entity. He's going around and doing stuff that the police department couldn't do. I pretty much enjoyed the film as a kid, mostly from that perspective, alongside maybe some of the jokes or humor that I understood. That was very superficial kind of stuff. When I saw the movie again, particularly for this podcast review, the scene where, I forget his name, but he was tasting the baby food that was designed for RoboCop's food source and seeing him enjoy it because of how he was reacting to the taste and stuff, that made me chuckle. I remember thinking back to a kid when I saw that. I think that was like one of the few scenes that I laughed to, and I still did, and I still do, you know, with years having gone by, you know, having a better understanding of, you know, the sort of humor that are incorporated into movies and stuff. This film does have, at least for me, some humorous scene, whether cheesy, his iconic line of, you know, you're coming with me dead or alive, like, to me, it still holds ground a lot, and hearing Murphy say that throughout the film, it still resonates with me, and it goes way back when I heard it as a kid, to all the other things that he would say to individuals that he come across. For example, he rescued that lady from those two individuals, and then, you know, the lady was like hugging him. At this point at the movie, he's still known as RoboCop. The way he reacted to her saying that, oh, madam, you're in distress, would you like a number to, I forget the name of the facility or department that he recommended, but it just made me laugh. So like, whether cheesy or was intentionally not to be cheesy, it's definitely one of the aspects of this film that I still appreciate a lot and still hold ground since I first heard it as a kid. Whether or not I understood the joke back then, it still held ground up to this day for me now that I can kind of consume it at that level. The story itself, it's not complicated. It's pretty simple. It kind of reminded me of the Bloodshot movie that Sal and I reviewed not too long ago. In the same idea that, you know, a man was taken down and was brought back to life and is now given these sort of skills or powers, however you want to put it. In this case, you know, Murphy is put into this robotic sort of being and he's out there doing what he's been programmed to do, but as he's doing this, he starts to recall his former self, and this causes the conflict of his character, which is pretty interesting because now you think to yourself, he's definitely going out of his way for the sake of revenge, you know, to seek these people, not just because they're bad people, you know, they're criminals and stuff, but they did this to him and he wants some sense of closure. Not only that, but they robbed him of his life and the family that, at least based on his memories, that he was very fond of, which kind of brings me to a point about the film that I wish I would have seen a little bit more. Just seeing Murphy before him getting turned into RoboCop, how his life was with his family. You know, give me a scene with how he was acting with his son, his wife, instead of just, you know, the flashback or the memory. I would have liked to see that in real time so that I could just connect with the relationship he had. Also, Sal already mentioned this, but Lewis, Murphy's partner, I would have liked that established a little bit more so I could really understand where Lewis is coming from and her not just being, you know, that one character who believed that RoboCop was Murphy and he was done wrong and she needed to be the one who kind of stands up for him. I needed that relationship to be built a little bit more so I could just, again, connect to the dynamic that was happening between the two characters, because it seemed like they really took off like on a really high note, and I just wanted them to ride on that high note for a little longer so that when things hit the fence that they're able to, you know, be there for one another and I can kind of believe in that trust that they have. Because the way Murphy ended up quote unquote dying before getting turned into RoboCop, it's really a representation of how, I don't know if it's just this particular police department in Detroit the movie was trying to portray, but they weren't really skilled at doing their job. The way they depicted Murphy and Lewis handling the situation that they got themselves into, from the car chase to when they ended up in the factory and confronting those guys. I mean, they should have known that there were a good, what, 5 or 6 of them there, and they went about it so casually. In a way, it was really their fault that the situation ended up the way it was. For Murphy to have just so lackadaisically walk up to, was it like 2 or 3 other guys, and forgetting that there were, you know, 2 or 3 other out there, and he could have just easily gotten ambushed. I guess maybe they were depicting Murphy to be sort of as, or even as a rookie. You would imagine that you would have the wherewithal of that sort of thing, especially having that car chase experience just, you know, happen right before that. That these guys are dangerous, you shouldn't take them lightly, and you should have entered that factory with more of like a precautionary sort of mentality instead of just walking to like a trap like that. So, you know, as a kid, I didn't think of anything like that because, you know, I was just more focused on, like I said earlier, the action stuff about this film. But having considered that now, I was like, you know what? It's not the fact that Murphy, again, died, I'm putting died in quotations here, in that particular scene, it's how it happened, how it led up to it. Like, had it happened in a more believable way, then I wouldn't put this in like a negative light. But to me, I thought how they were representing the task force here, I feel like the board meeting truly did capture the need to replace these guys, because again, the movie to me didn't do them justice in representing just the expectations you would have when it comes to these cops handling the situations that the movie presented them in. But the whole board meeting, that's another issue in of itself. I feel like it looks like everybody who's in that room, they lack this sense of seriousness, like them taking whatever happens in front of them too lightly, from the guy who ended up dying in front of their eyes because that one machine malfunctioned. The way they reacted didn't seem realistic to me, because if I was in that board meeting and I saw that happening to me, I would be like scared to death of the sort of technology that they were investing their money in. But they treated the situation very amusingly. You know, they were like, oh, you know, don't touch him, and call the paramedic. I was like, I think the dude is dead. That's what I was thinking. So, I mean, somebody died there. Again, things that went over my head as a kid, but watching it now, that's kind of like what came to me when I saw that scene. Even the individual who came up with the whole RoboCop idea, at first I thought he was like a guy who was standing for justice, but he just turned out to be another power-hungry individual who wanted to move up the ladder. To me, it's a shame, because I wish somebody in that board meeting who would have like stood that ground to just, you know, do whatever it takes to right the wrong, so to speak. But for him to have come up with the idea of the RoboCop design, and for him to act the way he did, I had conflicting feelings about that character. So I wish they would have just made that character be, you know, the guy who wanted to do things right. If he had to have like sacrificed himself, which he kind of was, but it's not like it wasn't like a self-sacrifice, like somebody came after him because that person's livelihood was being threatened by his invention. So even, you know, in the end, he sort of became an afterthought to me. The only characters who I cared about in this film was, of course, Murphy Lewis, to a extent, because she played a part in RoboCop's transformation or progression in this film, and Clarence, who I forever will consider the actor as Red Foreman from That 70s Show. So, as a kid, no reference, no idea of who this guy was, but, you know, having gone back and rewatched RoboCop and instantly realizing, hey, that's the dude from That 70s Show, you know, that brought a smile to my face. So, I would say those are the three characters who I felt the most attached to in this film. I guess one last thing before I give, like, my overall score of the film that I thought was, it was comical, but at the same time, it didn't look right, and I'm pretty sure there were a couple of this throughout the film, but this one was very noticeable, was the first interaction that RoboCop had with like a bad guy. It was the one who was trying to rob that convenience store, and when that guy was trying to run away and RoboCop pretty much put his arm out and sort of gave him a clothesline, the way that dude flew into that glass refrigeration sort of, you know, area, that did not look right, because that dude should have just gone clothesline and like fell to the ground, but he went flying. So that did not look right to me. So some of those stuff needed to be touched up, in my opinion. But I'm not sure if people had an issue with that, but for me, when I saw it, it's like, yeah, that, I don't think that's how physics works. So I just wanted to point that out. Other than that, I would say overall, you know, I still like the movie for like the action and the cheesiness of it. The story, again, pretty generic, nothing too out there. But I guess if you think about it in terms of when the movie came out, maybe it was revolutionary in terms of like execution of the story. I feel like that could have been handled better. And for me personally, I would welcome a remake in that department, not for the sake of trying to recapture who RoboCop is, because I think the film already did a great job in that, you know, it's a man who ended up being reinvented and who's struggling to understand who he is, and through his actions, he comes to term of what happened to him and how he's going to proceed with his life thereafter. I think the original already did a great job with that. The remake, which I haven't seen, which I should eventually watch, I want to see, you know, the execution of the story be handled better. That's the version of RoboCop that I would like to see in the remake. Again, just touching upon those stuff that I mentioned, from just seeing more of Murphy's family, the interaction between Murphy and Lewis, and how all of these characters sort of intertwine with one another. To me, that's where I would say I would welcome a remake, which, of course, a remake was made and came out in 2014. I think in the end, I'm going to give this film 2 scores. My first score is the score of watching it as a kid, from like that nostalgic sort of grading scale. Definitely, the movie is still like a 7.5 to like an 8.5, so I'm going to give like a movie an 8. But then as a reviewer of the film now, having rewatched it, it doesn't hold that high of a ground. It's still good. I would say a 6.5. Like I said, there are issues in this film. I mean, the stop motion, everything, that's great, but you know, if you were to compare it for it to its time, but in terms of like quality, it doesn't compare to like contemporary stuff. It depends, I guess, how you're looking at it.
So I agree with the idea that you said that some characters needed more backstories. Like I said, Murphy and Lewis. The only idea that I think I agree with you is that this movie doesn't need a remake, because they did do the remake in 2014. I saw it, but I don't agree that they should remake a remake of the remake, because they are making another movie, original movie. So they are rebooting the reboot. I don't understand why they're doing this. I mean, for me, this movie, it just seems the core idea is somebody who lost his identity and became a cyborg, but started to regain it. And at the end of the movie, it sums it pretty much. It's like when the old guy says, "Nice shooting, what's your name?" And he says, "Murphy." Instead of saying RoboCop, he says his name, Murphy, because he already regained his humanity again. And yes, he lost his family, but he regained who he was. That to me sums it up. He got lost, but he found his way. So for me, this movie is going to get a 7 out of 10. I believe that it still stands well. Yes, there is some errors in the movie. Some things could have been better. So I guess that does it for our review of RoboCop. Please join us next time when we're going to review Jaws.
You're going to need a bigger boat.
Please like, comment, and subscribe. You can find our social media links below. And like always, keep watching movies.